Thanks to the organisers for giving us the opportunity to speak here today. Apologies if you expected Tanya, but I'm filling in. Pat and I are really excited to be here to share our perspectives on RHDV in the field, and also recognising that the work that we're presenting is the culmination of a lot of people over many years. So thanks very much for their contributions. Now the slides aren't, there we go. Briefly, I'll talk a little bit about the history of rabbit calici viruses in Australia. I'm going to explain a little bit about the different variants contradicting this meme, we do care, or I'm trying to convince you why we do care. And then we'll hand over to Pat, who'll talk a little bit about what's changed with RHDV2 and then what we've learned about releasing RHDV in the field. So I think we're all pretty familiar with RHDV1, which is sometimes called the Czech virus or V351. And so that was the biocontrol strain that was released in the mid-90s. And what we saw is following that release that RHDV1 was less effective in those cooler, more humid parts of the country, so the southwest and the southeast. And when we looked at those rabbit populations specifically, we saw that rabbits from those regions actually had cross-protective antibodies present in their blood that protected against RHDV1, and those antibodies preceded the release of RHDV1. So there was something before RHDV1 that was protecting them against the knockdown effects of this virus. And that led to the discovery of this benign RCVA1 or rabbit calici virus A1 in 2009. And so it's a related calici virus that, again, if they've been exposed to RCV, they're then partially protected against virulent RHDV1 infection. And so that predominantly explained a lot of that the lack of efficacy in those regions. So the question then is, where did RCV come from? And it's likely that it probably came over with the first rabbits. It's highly prevalent in both domestic and wild rabbit populations. And because it's benign, we don't see it. So the same way that we're probably riddled with a bunch of viruses that we've never heard of because they don't make us sick, same thing. We didn't know about this virus because it didn't make anything sick until it started to interfere with RHDV1. So along with the cross-protective immunity from RCVA1 and the buildup of herd immunity over time against RHDV1, this prompted us to look for a new agent to boost biocontrol efforts. And after evaluation of a number of different viruses, this Korean variant, or K5, was selected. Primarily because of its enhanced ability to overcome the protection from RCVA1. So K5 is an RHDVA, and the A stands for antigenic variant, but it's still an RHDV1. So K5, very close to RHDV1, but it does slightly better overcome this RCV immunity. And of course, I think everybody here would be aware, K5 was then released nationally in 2017. However, where the confusion starts is prior to that coordinated release of K5, an additional calici virus made its way into Australia. And of course, that was RHDV2. So RHDV2 was not deliberately released. Genetic analysis shows that it's most closely related to a Portuguese strain. And so the question then is, well, if it's not deliberately released, how did it get here? I think we are all, it makes my job a lot easier now because we're all pretty familiar with what emerging viruses can do in naive populations. And so RHDV2 is pretty much the SARS-2 of rabbits. And so this is just a map of all the reported RHDV2 outbreaks globally since 2010. And so every little black dot on this map is a reported RHDV2 outbreak. And so Australia was just one more stop on its world tour, right? I mean, even in Singapore, like, who would have thought there's a sufficient rabbit population in Singapore for it to get into? But pretty much anywhere there's rabbits, RHDV2's got there. What I find really interesting is that the variant of RHDV2 that's in Australia is different to the variant that's in New Zealand. So again, multiple importation pathways, and once a virus gets in, it spreads. So RHDV2 spread like wildfire across the country. Apologies, the dots here are RHDV2 and they're in red, even though over here RHDV2 is in blue. But anyway, so very rapid spread across the country from east to west. And we saw replacement of those original RHDV1 strains. So decline in RHDV1 as RHDV2 really took over. And we also see that in the serological or the antibody profiles. So as RHDV2 antibody levels increase, we see a corresponding decline in RHDV1 and also actually in RCV. So again, RHDV2 really replacing the existing Khaleesi virus variants in Australia. And RHDV2 had a really dramatic impact on rabbit numbers. So the modelling has estimated a 60% population level mortality in wild rabbit populations across the country. Again, SARS-CoV-2 case fatality rates of 1%, less than 1%, 60% population level mortality in rabbits from RHDV2. So what that means is that by the time we got around to releasing K5, there weren't that many rabbits left and rabbit densities were quite low. And so K5 wasn't able to spread as efficiently. So we all know now the impacts that social distancing and lockdowns can have on disease transmission. And so again, by the time you've killed off 60% of your rabbits, there's a lot more social distancing going on and K5 wasn't really able to take off as previously anticipated. Okay, so how do we know all this? Well, we've only been able to figure this out because lovely people like you have been generous enough to submit samples to us for testing. So prior to the K5 release in 2017, this rabbit scan website was established. And so people can submit samples through that by clicking on this report disease button. And that takes you to a map screen with this info bar on the left, where you can elect to submit a sample, pop in your address, and a sample kit gets sent out to you. And so we test these liver samples to see whether it was Khaleesi virus that killed the rabbit, and if so, what strain. And then using that location information that we get as well, we can start to piece together this Khaleesi virus map of Australia. So please, this is definitely still active. If you do find dead rabbits and are keen to submit a sample, we would very much like to continue keeping track of these. Okay, so where are things at currently in terms of the different variants? So really, in addition to the original RHDV2, two new recombinant variants have emerged. And so, we've got China, the purple and pink dots down here. And so again, the same way that we had original SARS-2 and then Delta Omicron BA2, same sort of thing. We had, you know, the original RHDV2 and then we had, you know, one recombinant and then the next one and these successive waves. And so the important thing there is that for all intents and purposes, those recombinant variants are still RHDV2. So they're still pathogenic. They target the liver, they can kill kittens, they can infect rabbits and hares, and the immunity is completely cross-protective between all of those different RHDV2 variants. So you may see in places different nomenclature, but effectively they're all still RHDV2. So RHDV2 in particular, this pink variant is dominant across Australia. It just reached WA late last year and caused a fairly big outbreak there. And if you take all of those pink dots away, we still see sporadic K5 and RHDV1. But I think what's going to be interesting over the next couple of years is that with RHDV2 so widespread, population immunity to that variant is going to be increasing. And so eventually that may start to limit the natural outbreaks that we see with RHDV2 and its variants. And we may see a resurgence in K5 and RHDV1. So it's intriguing to speculate whether K5 and RHDV1 may actually have more impact now than they did back in 2017. When the dominant immunity was still RHDV1 because RHDV2 had only just arrived. So yeah, lots of exciting things, and that's why we care about variants. So from here, I'll hand over to Pat.
Thanks, Robin. As Robin has just described, RHDV2 and its recombinant viruses now dominant in the Australian rabbit population, and they circulate frequently across essentially the entire country. So the disease is epidemic with peak disease, or endemic rather, with peak disease activity occurring predominantly in spring, as you can see by these arrows here. This graph represents a number of RHDV2 positive dead rabbit samples voluntarily submitted for testing by land managers and pet owners from around the country. So what are the consequences of this RHDV2 dominant landscape? Well, we looked to try and understand this, we looked at the seasonality of short-lived RHDV antibodies. So these are antibodies that persist for sort of a few weeks to a few months in the rabbits. And we use these to sort of indicate that the virus had been through the population very recently. And we found that following the arrival of RHDV2, we saw a forward shift in the presence of these short-lived antibodies. So this blue peak that you can see here was prior to RHDV2 arrival, and then the red peak is after RHDV2 arrival. So this suggested that the virus was transmitting earlier in the year after RHDV2 arrived relative to before it arrived. But why might this happen? Well, we think it's got to do with the ability of RHDV to infect young rabbits, and I'll explain. So the very first major autumn rainfall for the year initiates the first annual flush of green grass, which consequently stimulates the very first rabbits to breed for the year. Both RHDV and RHDV2 are likely pretty consistently circulating or sort of persistent in the environment to some extent. So following the birth of these new young rabbits in autumn in an RHDV landscape, so prior to RHDV2, the virus tries to enter this new young rabbit population. But we know, as Robin's described, RHDV1 or RHDV only causes subclinical or sublethal infections, or subclinical and sublethal infections in these young rabbits. And this means that the rabbits rabbits shed minimal virus. We consequently get minimal environmental contamination of the environment with virus. Rabbit survives. And then as a combination of these three factors, we sort of get minimal continuing infections and continuing disease outbreaks. And it's not until these young rabbits that were born in autumn get a bit older, so a few months later in winter, that these infections and outbreaks can really start to happen more consistently. However, in an RHDV2 dominant landscape, we can get clinical and lethal infections as soon as these young rabbits are born after those early autumn rains, for example. Clinical infection means that the rabbits are shedding a large amount of the virus. So they consequently are contributing a lot to the contamination of the environment with the virus. We also, as a result of these clinical infections, we get rabbits dying. And when a rabbit dies, its carcass is absolutely loaded with virus. And we think this, the presence of this virus-laden carcass in the environment contributes a lot to the virus's transmission as well. And so then as a combination of these three factors, we then get ongoing infections, ongoing outbreaks that are occurring earlier earlier in the year with RHDV2 than what we previously saw. So if what I've described is that RHDV clinically and lethally infects young rabbits, does this sort of raises the question, could if RHDV2 was registered as an official biocide, could we then release it safely or appropriately at any time of the year? The timing of any RHDV release was always previously suggested to be of great importance because RHDV1 was subclinical or sublethal in those young rabbits. But as it turns out, despite RHDV2 having an ability to infect and kill young rabbits, it should not be released when young rabbits are present or in the rabbit breeding season. And the reason for this is that as the RHDV2 virus becomes established and dominant in Australia, the seroprevalence or immunity to the virus has also increased. This means that a large proportion of the new young rabbits born actually receive antibodies that protect them from the virus through their mother's milk. And as a recent study done by Robin has shown, these maternal antibodies protect against disease, but they don't protect against infection. And what this means is that young rabbits with maternal antibodies that are infected with RHDV2 won't die, but they will develop lifelong immunity to the virus. So neither RHDV1 or RHDV2, if it were to be registered, should be released when young rabbits are present. But unfortunately, some recent work that we've done suggests that this appears to be happening quite frequently. So this highlighted red area here, or this table is from a recent study that we did, and this highlighted red area here is when we suggest the virus should not be released. The top half of the table shows government curated data on the supply of RHDV to land managers for release, and the bottom half of the table shows virus releases that land managers are reporting through rabbit scan to have conducted themselves. And overall, we found that about 47% of virus supply and 74% of reported virus releases occurred during the major anticipated rabbit breeding seasons and when we would expect the risk of immunising young rabbits to be greatest. This is obviously of considerable concern and in the long run may contribute to making our rabbit problem worse as opposed to better, which is obviously not what any of us want. As part of this study, looking at when RHDV was supplied and released, we also summarised rabbit breeding patterns across sort of southern agricultural Australia. And as a general rule of thumb, across southern agricultural Australia, rabbits breed continuously between May and October. This means that we would expect young rabbits to be continuously present in the environment between approximately July and December, and the virus consequently should not be released during this period. So that's the July to December period. The optimal time of release is generally considered to be end of summer or start of autumn, so approximately February through to April. However, the sort of only exception to this would be if we had significant summer or early autumn rainfall. So we know that rabbits breed following the availability of green grass. So if you have lots of green grass in your area, then irrespective of what time of year it is, you should probably avoid releasing the virus as young rabbits will likely be present and rabbits are likely breeding. In general, though, if you're releasing the virus, we really encourage you and suggest that you should be integrating virus releases into a broader rabbit management approach that also includes applying conventional control methods and techniques such as wine ripping, fumigation, poison baiting, etc. These figures are some very preliminary work that I'm doing at the moment. And they suggest that, unfortunately, virus releases are often not being integrated with conventional controls and are instead often being used as standalone rabbit management techniques. This is problematic, as I mentioned, and we would advise against this and recommend to always integrate virus releases with the application of conventional control methods. I've produced these figures from data that land managers themselves have reported through rabbit scan, and each figure shows the use of RHDV on the x-axis and then the use of conventional control on the y-axis. And in short, basically, if we were seeing widespread integration of these control methods or virus release with conventional control, we should see a positive relationship. So the black line should be increasing from the left of the graph to the right of the graph. But as we can see, these relationships are all negative, so decreasing from the left to the right of the graph. And this sort of suggests that when people are using virus, they're not always accompanying that virus release with the implementation of conventional control. The release of virus, if not done appropriately, can have adverse impacts, as we've mentioned. The virus also circulates naturally. And so whether you release it or not, to some extent, the virus will come round and contribute to knocking down rabbits in your area. However, in contrast, any rabbit knockdown achieved using conventional control would not otherwise happen naturally if you, as the land manager, did not put the effort in. Conventional control, I should also mention, is very low risk in regards to, it's very, very unlikely that the application of any conventional control could do damage and cause rabbit numbers to increase. So in summary, now that RHDV2 is a dominant virus in the landscape, transmission to disease outbreaks are expected to be initiated earlier relative to when RHDV was dominant, or RHDV1. Also, we are watching you, not in a creepy way, but ultimately we hope that by you guys reporting what you're doing to manage rabbits through rabbit scan, we hope to be able to work with you all to optimize rabbit management for everyone and see rabbits and their impacts better managed across the entire country. So please continue to report what you're doing and when you're doing it through rabbit scan. Remember, don't release RHDV between July and December. Instead, if you're going to do a virus release, plan it to occur at the end of summer or very start of autumn. In most cases, this timing should avoid vaccinating any young rabbits and potentially doing damage. And lastly, practice integrated management, rabbit management. You'll get better results and the risks are minimized this way. Thank you from both Robin and I for having us. And thank you to all those many, many contributors to this program over the years. If you have any questions for either Robin or myself, we're happy to do our best to answer them.
Excellent. Thanks, Pat and Robin. Robin, I noticed that there was a question that came up about susceptibility following RHDV2 to K5, and you have answered that. But the question also related to myxomatosis. Would you think
rabbits Dave's, are more... Dave Peacock's going to be best to talk to the myxo-RHDV interaction, I think.
Okay. And I might bring Dave on a little bit later when we have a general session. One of the things that we certainly got from your talk, Pat, was that viruses are not the silver bullet and they do need to have integration with other management options to have the greatest impact. And that kind of relates to another question that Christian has raised here about gene drive, which is also potentially seen as a bit of a silver bullet. And I would imagine, when gene drive is released, sometime maybe in 10 to 15 years' time, so that partially answers one of your questions there, Christian, that there will be a need for an integrated approach to the management of rabbits, whatever the solutions, I guess. Would either Robin or Pat like to comment on management that might one day incorporate gene drive?
Do you want to talk to that, Pat, or do you want me to take it?
Maybe you take it. I haven't had much to do with gene drive in my time.
So I think gene drive is a really exciting prospect on the horizon. But I think what scientists, I'm going to use the inclusive term, have learnt from the whole GMO crops story and Monsanto dramas is that it's really important to start engaging with people early about acceptability, social license, all of those sort of things. And so gene drive, there's a lot of discussion around gene drive to get to have those conversations early, but we don't even know if it's going to work in mammals, particularly. I mean, there's some really promising results in mosquitoes and other insect species, but yeah, so I think trying to looking at how far into the future it's going to be rolled out, if the license, you know, if it gets approved and there's social acceptability there. And in terms of efficacy, there's just so many unknowns. So like, we don't have a good idea about rabbit population genetics. So again, for a gene drive to move through a population, we don't know whether rabbit populations are continuous or whether they're their own little populations and things like this, and how they related to European rabbit populations in enough detail. And so while those conversations are happening early, it's just, how or when it's going to roll out is a piece of string.
Okay, thank you very much, Robin.
I think it's probably important to mention also, or sort of re-emphasize what Richard said as well about gene drive, in that in a lot of cases it will be somewhat similar to our biocontrols, in that there is a potential that something like gene drive could be very effective, but it doesn't remove the need to do or use conventional control. As Robin was saying, based on the population structure of rabbits and whatever species that it is being used in, it is not necessarily by any means something that would completely eradicate rabbits. And so you have to stay on top of them through all the other means and avenues that you have available to you as well.
Good, thanks, Pat and Robin. I'm going to have to bring this to a close, and can I thank you very much for your talks.